Lim King Ming and his wife have been living in this four-room flat off Bedok Reservoir Road for the past 2 years. For King Ming, the modern surroundings are a big change from his childhood days when his family of 10 squeezed into one room in a pre-war shop house.
We only got one main tap to share amongst our four families. So as you see, daytime, they got to do cooking, they got to do washing, and other thing else. So the only time when the water is, the tap is not occupied, only during the night. So many of the family will try to keep some water for the following day's use.
The conditions that King Ming lived in were shared by many in the first half of this century. Slums had been sprouting up on the island in the late 1800s as migrants from India and China stretched the limits of available housing. Most of these migrants did not intend to stay, hoping to make their fortunes and then return home. All they could afford was a bed and a roof over their heads in tiny cubicles, mostly in Chinatown. With 1,000 people per acre in 1925, it was one of the most overcrowded areas in the world. There was no running water, no proper sanitation. Spread of disease was rampant. Makeshift huts were built wherever space was available. In 1927, the Singapore Improvement Trust, or SIT, was set up by the colonial government to look into Singapore's housing problems. The SIT built blocks of walk-up flats 4 to 7 stories high, but only managed 20,000 homes in 3 decades. It had other priorities, improving roads, demolishing slums, drawing up plans for Singapore. By the 1950s, the situation hardly improved. 8 out of 10 families living in the city had only one room to call their home. A 250,000 people lived in badly degenerated slums. 350,000 people lived in makeshift squatter huts. When Singapore attained self-government in 1959, housing was one of the new government's main concerns. The SIT was dissolved and the Housing and Development Board was set up on the 1st of February 1960. Its aim, to build homes as quickly as possible. The HDB directed its energies towards a new form of housing.
High-rise living or medium-rise living in the early days was a very radical departure from the existing style of living in Singapore and in many parts of the world. They consider high-rise living in pigeonholes to be very inhuman. And we actually embarked on this high-rise public housing development in a radical way, more than just because the idea is radical, but because we decided to do it for the majority of the people. It is an experiment not seen in any other part of the world except probably Hong Kong. Land shortage was one reason that caused us to resort to this drastically different approach to housing. It's really because we wanted to house everybody on the one hand, and we have to house everybody in a very limited piece of land.
Construction began in 1960. The HDB wasted no time. In the next 5 years, the board built 55,000 flats. So what was its biggest challenge?
When the housing board was formed, we lost a lot of our experienced staff. So the first thing we did was to try and recruit as many professional staff as we could. Anybody with a degree in architecture, engineering, we grabbed degree or diploma. Then building on such a massive scale, this was the first time any project of such size was undertaken in Singapore. We want to make sure that we have the requisite supplies of bricks, of cement, of granite, of sand, of steel. Then the other thing is we try to standardize the flat so that we can turn it out more or less like an assembly line.
Queenstown was the first satellite town to be completed in 1965. The early flats had one or two rooms with proper sanitation and running water. They were rented at a nominal cost, two-room flats for $20 and three-room flats for $46 a month. For many, it was a great change.
A kampung, it was this kind of flats, mosquitoes, and people who had to share the toilets. And it was a tap house, those kind of zincs and half a tap, but there's a likelihood of fire also. So sometimes one house catches fire, this can spread very easily to the whole kampung. So if we stay in housing board flats, we didn't have this worry.
Renting out flats was only a start. The intention was to allow every Singaporean to own a home. On the 12th of February 1964, the HDB announced its home ownership scheme. Families with a combined income of less than $1,000 a month were given the opportunity to own flats. Prices were subsidized. Two-room flats were sold for $4,900 and three-room flats at $6,200. Low-interest loans with repayment periods of up to 15 years were offered. The first balloting took place in August 1964. By the end of the year, 1,500 families had homes they could call their own. In September 1968, it became easier to own a flat when the government allowed CPF savings to be used to buy HDB flats. 13% of salaries went into CPF and all of it could be used to purchase flats. In 1965, over 1,500 families wanted to buy flats. By 1975, there were 150,000 applicants, a hundredfold increase. Home ownership had become a way of life, and the HDB met the demand for more flats. Between 1960 and 1975, the number of flats built annually by the HDB increased more than 25 times, from 1,600 in 1960 to 28,000 in 1975. By 1978, the backbone of housing shortage was broken, but the next step was to meet the needs for quality housing.
First of all, we have to create new towns which are self-sufficient, all the essential facilities are there, they're accessible, like MRT, expressway and so on. And also, we must create enough space for people to build schools, churches, temples, mosques, and even libraries and so on. The second thing, of course, is to keep looking at the design of the flats and also the organization of the blocks itself. We actually introduced the idea of precinct some 10 years ago. So we actually now have a concept of hierarchy of town, neighborhood. So there's a continuity of physical facilities available for them to use. And we're putting a lot of work in that area. And I think reaping results, because various surveys show that where the precincts are better designed, the awareness of community comes about much faster.
With higher standards of living, there's also a demand for bigger flats. Four-room flats were introduced in 1969, five rooms in 73, and maisonettes in 83. A few months ago, Joachim Marie and his family moved from their three-room flat in Queenstown to this brand new maisonette in Bishan. Here, the children have the luxury of a bedroom each and much more space.
Where do you see the values now?
The MRT is just a few minutes away, and when the neighborhood's fully developed, there will be shops and a market nearby. Today, more than 86% of Singapore's population live in homes built by the HDB. Most are located in satellite towns with all the necessary facilities. From the original concern of providing basic homes for the people, HDB living has come a long way towards improving the quality of life for Singaporeans and fostering closer community ties.